Good morning and welcome to our worship service this morning, and a special welcome to our visitors. If you're new in the Springfield, Clark County area or looking for a new church home, we invite you to make St. John your new church home. We begin with the Order of Confession and Forgiveness, which is page 94 in the front of your worship book. So I'd ask that you please turn to page 94, and I invite those who can do so without difficulty to please stand. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Almighty God, to whom our hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, and by what we have left undone.
We have not loved you with our whole heart.
We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us.
Forgive us, renew us, and lead us,
so that we delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin, and made us alive together in Christ. By grace you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen you with power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your hearts through faith. Amen. We now begin our worship with Word of God Come Down on Earth, hymn number 510 in the back of your worship. Hymn number 510.
God Come Down on Earth. It was written by James Quinn. He was born in 1919, but the music is from the 1600s. This is Johann Ave, 1600s. A very old hymn with the music, but with modern words.
Thank you.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Light and green darkness. I make wheel and green glow. I, the Lord, Second reading for today is from the first chapter of 1 Thessalonians. Paul, Silvanus, and Timothy, to the Church of the Thessalonians, and God the Father, and the Lord Jesus Christ, grace to you and peace. We always give thanks to God for all you who mentioned you in our prayers, constantly remembering before our God and Father your work of faith and labor of love and steadfastness of hope in our Lord Jesus Christ. For we know, brothers and sisters, beloved by God, that he has chosen you, because our message of the gospel came to you not in word only, but also in the power and the Holy Spirit of full conviction. Just as you know what kind of persons we proved to be among you for your sake, and you became imitators of us and of the Lord, for in spite of persecution, you received the word with joy and inspired by the Holy Spirit, so that you became an example to all believers in Macedonia and Achaia. For the word of the Lord has sounded forth from you, not only in Macedonia and Achaia, but in every place your faith in God has become known, so that we have no need to speak about it, for the people of those regions report about us and what kind of welcome we had among you, and how you turned to God from idols to serve a living and true God, and to wait for his Son from heaven, be raised from the dead, Jesus, who rescues us from the wrath that is coming. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
It is time now for the reading of the gospel, the words of Jesus Christ. Our pastor is Pastor John Pollock, and he is here. Here with us, and he's standing right by Pastor Pollock as they read the scripture together in the gospel lesson.
The service on the Tuesday before Thanksgiving as usual, But this year we're going to do something a little different to entice more of you to attend, and that is from 6 to 7 we will have a light supper. It won't be turkey, but it will be a light supper for you to eat and then come up here into the church and celebrate our National Day of Thanksgiving, giving thanks to God for all his blessings. So that will be November 21st. Now I ask that you give your attention to our praise band.
Thank you.
you may take out your sermon notes for today, the importance of thanks and prayer. Sermon text being the second reading for today, first chapter of St. Paul's first letter to the Thessalonians, focusing on verse 2. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. In Mexico, I am told, there are some regions where there are hot springs and cold springs right by each other. And this makes for a convenient laundry service for the women in the villages, as they can bring their clothes and wash their clothes in the hot springs and then rinse them in the cold springs. So an American tourist on a bus trip went by one of such situations, and he said to the guy, he said, "I bet these ladies are really thankful to Mother Nature for making such a convenient laundry facility for them." To which the guy just shook his head and he said, "No." He said, "The reality is these ladies complain all the time because Mother Nature didn't provide them with any soap." The attitude of these village ladies, unfortunately, reflects the attitude of too many people today. And that is, instead of giving thanks for what they have, they focus on the negatives of what they don't have. Instead of being thankful that they have been blessed with the situation at hand, they complain about the situation they wish they could obtain. And so even Christians today, we see, instead of being positive and giving thanks, oftentimes are complaining and filled with negativity. No matter what we have, we still want to complain. We contrast that with the attitude of St. Paul as he is writing this first letter to the Thessalonians, where in this second verse he says, quote, "We always give thanks to God for all of you and mention you in our prayers constantly." We always give thanks to God. Now, St. Paul's writing to a group of Christians in a town where he was run out of. And yet he continues to give thanks. He sends Timothy there, and Timothy comes back with a much brighter report that the church is growing, and that the persecutions and the resistance that St. Paul encountered has died off, or at least is dying down, and the church is beginning to grow. So St. Paul is telling us that no matter what kind of situation we find ourselves in, we should always pray and give thanks to God. That this should be the attitude of every Christian, to daily pray and give thanks. As we look at these words of St. Paul, the phrase "always give," that is a Greek word or words that means to be ready for something, to be alert for an opportunity to do something. So he's saying that we as brothers and sisters in Jesus Christ, no matter where we're located, that we are always to be alert, on the ready, on guard, to offer prayer and thanks to God for one another and for the universal church. That we are not just to focus our prayer on ourselves or our families or our local congregation, which it is proper not to pray for those, but that shouldn't be our entire focus. We should always remember as well to pray for all of our brothers and sisters around the world who are believers in Jesus Christ. And so always give means always to be ready. Be on guard like that sentry on the wall who is watching to make sure the enemy doesn't sneak in and breach the walls and conquer the city. So you're always alert, waiting for that opportunity when you can pray for the entire church. The word thanks simply means thanks, but what is interesting about it is the Greek word is the word from which we derive our English word Eucharist. thanksgiving. That's what Eucharist means. When we refer to the Lord's Supper or the sacrament of the altar, Holy Communion, as the Eucharist, we're saying it is the feast of thanksgiving. It is the meal of thanksgiving. Thanksgiving for what? Thanks, giving thanks to God for sending His Son, Jesus Christ, to die upon the cross, to make atonement for the sins that we commit, to pay in full those sins that we are in debt for. And thanking God for that, because Jesus died on that cross, because He rose on that third day, because He ascended into heaven, where He waits to come to judge the living and the dead, we have that gift and assurance also of eternal life. So it is a meal of thanksgiving. So that is why that term Eucharist has become so popular in the modern day. This is the service or feast of thanksgiving. The word all, that little bitty word all, is very important in what St. Paul is saying, because it means every believer. We always give thanks to God for all of you, for every believer. St. Paul's not limiting this to denominational labels. St. Paul's not limiting this to where you live, what country, or what city, or what state, or county. He's not limited to race, creed, color, ethnic origin. He's talking about all Christians. Pray for all Christians. The word also means that everyone is important. It is stressing the fact that it is every member of the church. It means that we are all called, that we're not in a community of faith by accident, but we are here because we've been called by God through Jesus Christ to be a child of the Heavenly Father. And the word means, more importantly, that you are someone. You may not be anybody to the gossip pages. You may not be anybody to the newspapers. Into the media. You may not be anybody in your neighborhood to your neighbors. You may not even be anybody to your people you're sitting with in the pew to worship God. But to God, you are somebody and you are important, and therefore you should be grateful. You just don't pray for the giants of faith like Billy Graham, but we pray for every Christian, whether they're famous or not. Because we all need that strength, we all need that encouragement, we all need that support as brothers and sisters in Christ Jesus. The word mention, when he says, give thanks to God for all of you and mention you in prayers. Constantly mention means to recall something, to remember it, to bring it to mind. And then constantly means without a lapse of time. In other words, you don't say, well, third Sunday of every second month, we'll pray for the universal church. No, it means you pray for all your brothers and sisters in Christ each and every day. You don't let a time period lapse where you don't pray for your other brothers and sisters in Christ. And so there is an important lesson that St. Paul is teaching us, and that lesson is the importance of praying for our brothers and sisters wherever they may be. Whatever denominational tag they may have, whatever race, creed, or color, ethnic origin they may be, it is important that we pray for them. Praying for them so that we encourage one another, we support one another, we watch out for one another. Because not to do so can cause one to have a lack of enthusiasm for what they're doing. If we don't pray for our brothers and sisters in Christ and they don't pray for us, we can decide that being an active Christian isn't important. I mean, why do it? Nobody cares about it. Nobody says it. The Duke of Wellington, the hero of the Battle of Waterloo, the man that finally defeated Napoleon and all his grand desires. It was said that to be the chef of the Duke of Wellington was one of the prize jobs in London. That if you could be his chef, and you were really up there in the culinary world. So an opening came for the chef's place, Duke of Wellington's house, and this fellow applied, and he handkerchief. His colleagues were shocked when only 2 months after taking the job, he quit. They asked him, "Why did you quit? This is one of the plum jobs in the entire city." And the sheriff responded, he said, "When I made a good deal, the Duke said nothing. When I made a bad deal, the Duke said nothing. It just got to the point where it wasn't worth it." So when you're doing the work and nobody says anything, nobody encourages you, nobody supports you, nobody lifts you up, then you think it is nothing. It's not worthwhile. I'm doing it. And that is a danger that can happen in our life of faith. If we do not feel the prayers of our brothers and sisters in Christ, we throw up our hands and say, "Is this really worth it?" Instead of being part of the community of faith, maybe I ought to do like some of those early Christians that went out and lived in a cave by themselves or on a high point out in the desert somewhere where they spent all day praying and studying Scripture. Because after all, the community's not caring for them. So we do not want that attitude to develop among our fellow Christians. But it will if we never pray for them, never encourage them, never thank them. So it is important that we pray for all people. Those of you who are my age and older probably will remember, first of all, the black hymnal that was called the Common Service Looking Hymnal that I can vaguely remember in the middle 50s our church. Then came out the service book and hymnal, the first read hymnal that we had in the Lutheran church. And in both of those, after the creed, there was something called the prayer of the church. And in those days, it was a custom that the pastor then would pray a long prayer covering everything in the church and covering the entire church. And the emphasis was on the universal church, the one holy Catholic Apostolic Church. Catholic, little c, meaning every true believer in Jesus Christ. And so it would be a general prayer, sometimes having specific topics mentioned, depending on what was going on in the world. But the emphasis was on the entire church. So then in the 70s, out came the LBW, the Green Hymn. And instead of the prayer of the church, after the creed, it now was intercessory prayer, or prayers of intercession. So instead of being one long prayer, and there were pastors like Pastor Kagan who could give that long prayer and turn it into poetry and 30 minutes long, but anyhow, instead of having those kinds of prayer, we went to praying petitions. Which is fine, that's a perfectly legitimate form of prayer, as petitional prayer. But the emphasis became more focused on local and not universal. It even became where, which you had never done before, at least in the Lutheran church I grew up in, had never done before, you begin to actually mention people's names. If they were sick or if they had lost a family member. And so more and more, they became more focused just on the local congregation and its needs for giving the universal church. Of course, like anything else, when you make things more local and you start using people's names, you have some people that, you know, they want to see their name in the bulletin every week, whether they're still really sick or not. And you have to leave their name out, and they're raising Cain because you left their name out for a week. The other problem is, if you were broadcasting your service live, like we used to do over the radio, or if it's on TV, or if it's on YouTube, like ours is now, you have privacy concerns. You have to worry about HIPAA, which is you cannot release information about somebody in the hospital unless their family gives you a call. You cannot mention people who passed away unless the family wants it to be said, because you have unscrupulous people watching these programs that look up those names and take advantage of when you're not at home. That's why newspapers don't publish addresses anymore in the obituary. So then you had those problems, the privacy concerns. Some people don't want their name mentioned, don't want it in the bulletin, don't want it being said over the airwaves. But the point is, we were getting away from the idea of the whole church, like St. Paul's talking about today. We were forgetting about our brothers and sisters, especially in those areas of the world where they are persecuted for being a Christian, where being a Christian can cause them to lose their job, can cause them to wait last for food or basic services, can cause them to be driven out of their neighborhood and out of their centuries-old home. So St. Paul is reminding us today, pray always, giving thanks to God for all Christians, for all of us, no matter what our situation is. With a positive attitude like St. Paul's, praying constantly and being thankful in prayer, the church can do wonders. And that's something I think our 21st century church has forgotten, is that a praying church filled with the power of the Holy Spirit can do wonders never imagined. But if you don't take advantage of the power of the Holy Spirit, if you don't take advantage of the power of prayer, then you just sit there stagnant, just rolling along, slowly disappearing. So often Christians develop an attitude much like the world, too often not being thankful for what they have, but instead complaining. Remember, when God gave Moses the Ten Commandments, twice he mentions covenant, that we're not to covet what our neighbor has. And instead, we're supposed to be thankful for what we have and use that to the best of our ability to serve God and glorify God. But even we Christians find ourselves today coveting what somebody else has. I can remember, I don't know if it still goes on because I don't have any connection with seminaries anymore, but I can remember when I was in Griffith and I was in a lot of contact with the Lutheran Seminary in Chicago. And I had two interns from the seminary while I was serving up there, especially with some second career people. And even with some people who went the traditional path like I did, right from college to seminary. You had some coming out thinking that they should immediately go into a church that was large instead of serving a smaller church and building their resume, if you will, and showing their strengths and showing whether or not they were capable of handling a church a step up. And so instead of being thankful that they had a call, after 4 years of college and 4 years of seminary, we're now going to be able to proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ. They were complaining about the fact that we're going to take some church with only 40 people a Sunday in the dying part of town instead of going to the big fancy church in the suburbs with 1,000 members. St. Paul is warning us of that. We are to pray and give thanks for what we have. Pray and give thanks for the blessings that God puts upon us. There was a grandmother. One Sunday after church, she took her grandson, who was the apple of her eye, on a walk along the ocean. And the little boy was dressed in his Sunday finest from hat to shoes. And as they were walking along, suddenly a big wave came up out of the ocean and it swept the little grandson away. The grandmother began immediately praying fervently to God to bring back her grandson. And if he would bring back her grandson, she would dedicate her life to serving God the rest of her natural days. Suddenly another big wave came and hit the shore and disappeared. And as it did, there was her little grandson, unhurt, unharmed, soaking wet, his hair all disheveled. Grandma looked at him. She looked up to heaven and she said, "You know, Lord, he did have a hat."
focus on the negative instead of on the positive. And St. Paul's reminding us today to be positive. Always give thanks to God for you. St. Paul is showing us that we always give thanks to God in prayer, if for nothing else. If we can't think of any blessing, we should thank Him for the grace that God shows us through His faith, through faith in His Son. If you're having a bad day, nothing's going right, you're fighting with your spouse, fighting with your kids, work was a disaster, the news is horrible, your favorite team just got blown out when they were supposed to win, you still can give thanks to God that He has saved you by faith through grace in His Son, Jesus Christ. And you'll be amazed at how better suddenly everything will be. Give thanks that we don't have to earn that salvation, that God has done it all through Jesus. All we have to do is be thankful. So it is important for the life of the church, for the life of the congregation, and for the life of the individual Christian, that the attitude of St. Paul be adopted as we continue our pilgrimage on earth. To give thanks to God always. Amen. Peace of God which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen. Let us now sing, "Where Can I Go?" which is page 4 in your bulletin. It's in your bulletin instead of insert. It's actually page 4 of your bulletin. Where Can I Go?
This hymn was written by James Coates. Also, he wrote the music, and it's written in 1940. American hymn, "Where Could I Go But to the Lord?" This is remembering that Peter said that, "Lord, to whom shall we go? You know the words of eternal life. Where could I go but to the Lord?" And this is setting that to music, what Peter confessed, that, "Lord, we shall only go to you."
Thank you.
With the whole church, let us confess our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Amen.
You may be seated.
It's time for our offering. We're bringing our gifts to God in thanksgiving to Him for all the things He has done for us. We spend this whole hour in prayer and meditation. This is only 1 hour out of the week that we spend. We learned that Martin Luther spent 2 hours every single day in prayer. We could not match that, but it would be a good thing because we should be thankful to God. Listen to the praise band now. Singing, playing again.
Thank you.
morning for our prayer, we are reverting back to the prayer of the day, as I talked about, so there will be no response. Let us pray. God, our Father, you have invited us to raise our prayers to you in the name of Jesus, your beloved Son, and have promised to hear and answer us with all that is best for us. Give us confidence that we may call upon you as a people of your name, and teach us to be content with what your wisdom and love supply. You have loved and chosen us according to your mercy, and called us through the living voice of your word. Grant to us the helpful spirit of your grace, that what you have begun in us may be brought to completion when Christ appears in his glory on the last day. Furnish your church, O Lord, with such grace, that she with robes washed in the blood of the Lamb may be adorned as a bride for the heavenly bridegroom, Jesus Christ. Grant to her readiness to sacrifice, a zeal for your cause, and faithfulness to your word, that she may never falter in her holy calling. Give repentance to your people, and clothe them with garments of faith, hope, and love. Send your servants into all the nations, open in the hearts of all who hear your gospel, and crown their labors with success. Dear God, have dominion over all the earth, and bring all rulers to your obedience, to the end that all tyranny and oppression may be banished, the love of war and lust for power broken, and the worship of false gods destroyed. May your blessings be upon our own nation, reviving us in our midst the esteem of honor, truth, purity, true religion, and the works of faith. Teach our families to wait upon you in every necessity, and provide for them in due season all such things as they may need for body or spirit. Grant that all who are in sickness or sorrow, tribulation or danger, or who have suffered disappointment or injustice, may increase in faith and love, be kept by your mighty hand, and be delivered out of all their woes. These things we ask you, O God, to grant to us in the name of Christ Jesus, our Savior and Lord, and for his sake, who has taught us to say when we pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. May the Almighty and merciful God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, bless, comfort, strengthen, and keep us, now and forever. Amen. We conclude our worship with O Word of God Incarnate, hymn number 514, in the back of your worship. Hymn number 514.
This hymn was written by William H. Howe, who lived in the 1800s, but the tune is from Germany, Gesangbuch, M-E-I-N-I-N-G-E-N, 1693-1600s, Word of God Incarnate. And as the praise band sang, He who lives inside of us, who is in control of us, Jesus is within us. He's greater than that in the world. We can rely on Jesus. We can be thankful to God.
Thank you.
grateful that we've had this hour with God to thank Him, to praise Him, that He is merciful to us. We pray that He would grant His mercy to those who are in need, those who are not like us, that may be a different color skin, a different nationality, but we love them. They are one in You and one in Christ. We want to give an invitation to come to our Yuletide Festival, November the 16th, 17th, and 18th. November the 16th is the Italian kickoff dinner, and that's Thursday. And Friday the 17th, 9 a.m. to 6 p.m. is donations, the live auction, and for the vendor booths. We have Swiss steak that night, 5 p.m. to 16 p.m. Live auction is at 7. Then Saturday, November the 18th is breakfast with Santa, 8:30 to 10. And then 9 to 4 is the vendors. You can buy things from the vendors here in our gymnasium. Dinners are $10 for adults, children 12 and under, $5 and under 3 free. Swiss steak, ham loaf, Santa breakfast will be $10 for a family of 4, and singles are $3 each. We can use volunteers to set up. Also, we'll give the announcement that we have a daycare center. Children can learn about Jesus. They may not have any other opportunity. You can help to save them, to give them Jesus in their lives. You can invite Jesus to come into our hearts, to be Lord of our lives. We invite you to come to our Yuletide Festival. You may be selling Meyer raffle tickets for the $750 gift at the Yuletide Festival. Also, the youth group is going ice skating and lunch at the chiller, 12:30 p.m. on Sunday, November the 5th. That's after the 10:30 service. Attendees must attend church the day of the event. Any questions, call Nancy Lewis. The flowers today are beautiful live flowers on the altar, and they are presented by Pam Riggs in loving memory of her father, Lowell Kramer, and by Linda Fox in honor of her two new granddaughters, Mavis LaValle and Suzanne Hutchison. So we have beautiful flowers on our altar today, and they're given by members of the congregation. We thank God that we are able to be here and worship Him. We are thankful for all the gifts He's given to us, and we're not asking for anything more, but we're just thankful for what we have. We ask that we might be used to help others, and that we might pray for those in need in other lands and in our land. And we pray that we would be gracious to them, grateful to You, God, and gracious to those who are with us. Word of God incarnate, we need You every hour. Almighty God, where would we go but to the Lord? We are thankful that we can go to Jesus, He can be within us, and He can bless us every day. We are to pray constantly. God asks us to do that, and we should respond to His call.